Start streaming. Yay. Is it coming up? Yay. Oh, it's wait, don't tell me. Don't tell me. God, how this group is. There we go.
Harvard Pilgrim is proud to sponsor the 89.7.
That's just coming for one ear, which is so annoying. Why is that in stereo?
Or it's a better place than we might have been 2 weeks ago.
How much equipment have you gotten from the federal stockpile?
Not enough. We get about a fraction of what we ask for. We're never sure if it's coming from the stockpile or from other locations. And I think you said it best, the ventilators is really the item that everybody is looking for and the most difficult thing to obtain. I think we would be comfortable in Illinois if we knew we had about 4,000 plus ventilators on hand right now. That number is under 2,000. And when we do get a hold of ventilators, you're talking about maybe 20, 30, 40, 100 at a time, if we're lucky.
And the Trump administration has set up this hybrid system where FEMA is working with private distributors, private manufacturers to try to direct much needed supplies to hotspots. The feds say, you know, we're adding volume to this existing supply chain, but we're not here to disrupt it. And many governors are saying that's clearly not working. Supplies are still going, you know, at times to the highest bidder or a long-standing customer. Given that this crisis is going to go on for many weeks, what does Governor Pritzker think the federal government can and should do right now to better help states and improve this supply chain?
Well, let me start by saying the current system is a total mess. States are bidding against each other. They're bidding against other nations. I listened to my boss on a call 2 weeks ago where the person he was talking to was telling us about the order that they had just gotten in from the Israelis. And clearly the subtle indication to us was we needed to kind of either up our order or probably lose out on the supplies we were trying to get. It really, as my boss has said over and over, it really, really is the wild, wild west. You're asking states who are putting together procurement teams who, truthfully, in normal times, state procurement goes through a long, kind of drawn-out bureaucratic process in order to get supplies in. And you're taking that entire process, compressing it into really hours sometimes, if not days. And talking to companies that are bidding up the prices of really fundamental medical equipment, for example, an N95 mask, which before all this began, you know, prices were usually about under a dollar for a mask. We've been quoted $6, $7, $8 a mask, which, as you might imagine, when you're buying millions upon millions of masks, how expensive that gets for states. So I don't know how this is a long-term sustainable system to have. What we really have said we needed is the federal government to use the Defense Production Act to really normalize the production chain and give everybody a decent shot of purchasing these supplies at a price that's not exorbitant or really just out of reach for some states.
I have a question. How does it look for you? I mean, you describe it as the Wild West. Is it if someone calls out of the blue and says, hey, I've got a line on some medical gowns, do you take that call? You know, you might not know exactly who they are or how much they can really give you?
Valentine's Day purchase.
We do. We actually take every call, email, suggestion. I think I probably get anywhere from 100 to 200 emails and text messages about this every 2 days.
We
set up a procurement team inside the governor's office where all of that, those outreaches get relayed. And then we start the process of trying to vet these people, which has become increasingly difficult, I will tell you, because oftentimes, almost always, you're talking to the actual manufacturer of the product. You are talking to a middleman who may be working for another middleman. Often they're venture capital people. They're folks who, I'm just guessing, have seen an opportunity here. And they're playing the connectors. They're also taking a cut off the top of whatever, you know, we end up paying for the masks or the ventilators, whatever supply we're getting in. And you know, you're trying to really vet these folks and to make sure that they're real and it's not a scam. And you know, I would say the other difficulty here is a lot of these supplies are being manufactured overseas, and in fact, a lot of them are being manufactured in China. So getting them out of China at the moment is also a huge hurdle that we have to leap in order to get the supplies in the front door here in Illinois.
Anne, has there been any discussion among governors, given that clearly there's a lack of leadership at the federal level, to have states sort of join forces, set up a kind of cooperative clearinghouse to buy this critical equipment and supplies and stop these sort of bidding wars?
Non-kosher meat.
There has, actually. My boss has reached out to a couple of Midwestern governors, and I know he's had conversations with some folks on the coast. I think the problem is all of these states have different procurement rules. A lot of the providers and manufacturers, they want money up front. You know, they either want you to pay the entire bill as soon as you place the order, or they want a substantial amount of money before they will fulfill the order. And it's very difficult to work amongst states who all have different procurement rules. In fact, they have all have different abilities to pay. You're trying to keep people, you know, kind of all in the same room when they need, you know, these really critical supplies. And I would say, particularly with anything involving ventilators, it's hard to collaborate because, again, you're looking at 20, 30, maybe 40 ventilators at a time. And, you know, every state's kind of looking at that going, I need that supply for my people. So it makes it very difficult to collaborate. I would also say there's obviously a disparity among states that can front huge upfront costs. I did see that the governor of California was able to bring in a huge number of supplies. But basically that was because he was able to put $500 million down.
I was about to ask. To get things briefly, we only have 20 seconds left. What is this doing to your state's budget?
We've been able to free up the funds that we need in order to take care of this, but it is going to be a blow to the budget. I think my boss has said this over and over again. You're taking on huge unexpected costs at the same time that you're losing a lot of your sales tax revenue, and we've pushed back the date for people to file state income tax, so you know your revenue flow isn't what it normally would be.
That's Anne Caprera, Chief of Staff to Governor Pritzker. Thank you
title, Mrs.
Thank you.
And NPR's Eric Westervelt, thanks to you.
You're welcome.
And you're listening to NPR News.
Support for the Publix Radio comes from United Way 211 in Rhode Island. Connecting people with services and answering questions concerning the COVID-19 crisis.
Okay.
Information by dialing 211. Also from Rustigians. Offering a fully modernized cleaning operation with centrifugal force equipment for rinsing and drying.
This is so hard.
One Governor Street and at RustigianRugs.com. And from the American Mathematical Society, headquartered in Providence and online at AMS.org, serving 30,000 members and the worldwide mathematical community.
Does my Spotify work on this computer? Yeah, whatever.
Fatalities in the U.S. has now surpassed Italy. About 20,000 people have died in the U.S. from the coronavirus, more than 8,600 of them in New York State. British Prime Minister Boris Johnson says he owes his life to the staff at the National Health Service.
Oh, doing this can help me, right? Because
Johnson made his first public appearance
all the
since he was moved out of intensive care at St. Thomas's Hospital in London. And Joe Biden has picked up more delegates. The former vice president won Alaska's Democratic primary Saturday. He beat Senator Bernie Sanders by just over 10 points. I'm Lori London, NPR News,
you win
Washington.
This, I lost. What? Roof patio.
Support for NPR comes from this station and from Noom, providing an online evaluation and the tools to help people lead healthier lives through behavior change. More information at Noom, N-O-O-M.com. Learning.com. From Lindemood Bell Learning Centers, with instruction to help students reach their learning potential. Summer programs for reading comprehension and Arsenal. Math. Learn more at lindemoodbell.com/NPR. And from the listeners who support this NPR station.
This is Weekend Edition from NPR News. I'm Lulu Garcia-Navarro. The only way we'll truly get a hold of this pandemic and come out the other side is through science, ultimately with a vaccine, but in the meantime, through testing. There are tests that determine if someone who is sick has COVID-19 by taking nasal swabs, but also important is something called antibody or serological tests. And one of the places that's doing that is Stanford University. Joining us now is Dr. Jay Bhattacharya, professor of medicine at Stanford University, who is part of this study. Good morning.
Good morning.
I read about long lines of cars with people showing up to give blood samples for this surveillance study that you just conducted. In all, volunteers collected blood from, I think, around 3,000 people. What were you looking for?
It was actually amazing, the community response.
The main thing we're aiming for
is to find out what fraction of the population in Santa Clara County have had history of exposure and infection with COVID-19. The test that people use to identify active infection just checks to see if the virus is there. But once you've cleared it, which is true for most people, actually, that they won't have the virus in them, but they will instead have antibodies to the virus. And that's what we're looking for, antibodies to the virus that provides evidence that there was previous infection, and sometimes also current infection.
So how can this information be used?
So all of the models that project forward for what the epidemic is going to look like require an understanding of how many people have been infected, not just how many people have been infected and identified
for the infection, but
the total number of people, including people who have recovered. If you don't know that, you don't know how far along the epidemic you are. You can't project forward. So it's really useful for that kind of purpose to project where the epidemic is actually headed. The other thing is really useful for is understanding the death rate. To date, most people that have been trying to calculate death rate have tried to guess how many people have been infected, but we don't know how many people total have actually been infected.
And that's because, of course, a lot of people are asymptomatic, so you could be walking around and feeling fine, and yet you are actually infected with the coronavirus.
Exactly. There's that. And there's also people who, you know, they have relatively mild illness. They think it's a cold and they don't show up. We'll miss them unless you do a study like the one we're doing where we can look for antibody evidence in the population.
Practically speaking, one of the reasons that this is, of course, really interesting to governments in particular is because that this may mean that if a person has already had the virus, those people could then go back to work or potentially back to school. So if you could test them and see if they had immunity, then maybe you could give them a pass to be able to re-engage in their lives.
Yeah, people have been talking about those kinds of things. I think there's still an active debate about in the scientific community about the extent of the immunity you get from the antibodies. I believe there's some, but there's how long lasting they are. There's also questions about is it the right thing to do to have these? It's like you have to be antibody positive before you can go to work. It seems like it would be a difficult thing to implement. I don't think a policy that relies on testing positive for the antibody and allow you to go back to work is likely to be feasible, and it would also create incentives for people to try to go get infected. I'm not sure I favor such a policy, but
COVID parties, like chicken pox parties, is terrifying.
I think that could happen.
I'd like to talk about the death rate. You spoke about the fact that you believed the death rate might be much lower than what had been originally predicted. We have north of 500,000 confirmed cases in the United States, the most of any country in the world. We've now surpassed Italy in the number of deaths. What do you think these serological tests may show us about the death rate, and how can that help inform us here?
Yeah, I mean, I think the problem is there's no vaccine, right? So even if the death rate's 0.1% or lower, that still means a lot of people may die from it. And that's something we have to take very, very seriously. We also have to take seriously the fact on the other side of that is the economic shutdown will have consequences for health and mortality around the world. It's hard to overstress this. When the world is poorer, more people will die, shorter lives and unhealthier lives, not just in the United States, but around the world. The Great Recession produced famously a phenomenon of decreases in life expectancy in the United States for the first time since World War II. a very large-scale economic collapse
make things
that produces bad health outcomes. That, I think, is firmly established fact. How extensively those deaths are going to be, those loss of health is going to be, and how far around the world, that's something I think is going to need some very, very careful attention and thinking. Because if we continue the shutdown for, I've seen people argue that we should continue the shutdown until there's a vaccine, say that lasts a year. Well, a year of global depression will have an enormous consequence on people around the world. I mean, there are poor countries where people are on the brink of starvation just in normal good times. So I think trying to understand what the right policy is involves understanding the deaths on both sides of this. That's where I am. I want to understand those better so we can make better policy. Because right now, all of the focus has been on the deaths on COVID. Once we understand that, I think we need to see what the actual trade-offs between the deaths on one side of the policy on the other side, and then make an informed choice on the basis of that.
That's Dr. Jay Bhattacharya, a professor with Stanford Health Policy. Thank you very much.
Thank you. My pleasure, Lulu.
Tens of thousands of women across the country trying to have a baby through fertility treatments have had to postpone their appointments indefinitely following COVID-19 guidelines by the American Society for Reproductive Medicine.
Oh.
NPR's Sasha Pfeiffer reports that some fertility specialists and their patients are pushing back.
At her home in Fort Worth, Texas, Amy Schmidt-Zook's bathroom cabinet is a miniature pharmacy of medicine and medical equipment.
An endless supply of syringes and needles, alcohol swabs, cotton pads. I have a package of medications for stimulating your ovaries.
That's all for her fertility treatments. Zook is 43, married, and wants to have a third child, but doctors say her chances are slim. So she's been trying in vitro fertilization, or IVF. But a few weeks ago, Zook's fertility clinic told her it was suspending new treatments with no restart date given. Many other clinics nationwide have done the same.
I've never felt so old in my life. You know, like at 43, like I'm really falling off the cliff of fertility. And it's just like, oh my gosh, this really could be the end of it.
The U.S. guidelines are similar to recommendations by fertility groups in Europe and Canada. There are exceptions, like for people with cancer who want to freeze eggs or sperm before starting chemotherapy, but those apply to relatively few patients.
When I first saw the guidelines, I was shocked.
That's Zook's fertility specialist, Dr. Beverly Reed.
What? And then I said, okay, well, these are the guidelines. I've just got to follow them.
Reed works at a clinic near Dallas and eventually came to oppose the guidelines. So she started a petition protesting them. About 15,000 people nationwide have signed it so far.
Things gone up to the bathroom
Reed
one,
says the guidelines unfairly discriminate against fertility patients.
It's cartilage
especially
everywhere
sex couples
and single people
accidentally who have fewer options to get pregnant on their own. And
these
even though
like
the risks of COVID-19 are still being studied,
Reed
thinks patients should be able to decide for themselves if they want to continue treatments.
I have patients who are willing to take that risk, who say, yes, I understand it may be dangerous, but I'm okay with that because I still
need
want to
user
try to
ID.
My family. And if I don't get to do it now, I may never get to do it.
But Dr. David Adamson says so little is known about how the new coronavirus could affect unborn babies that patients cannot make an educated decision about the wisdom of continuing treatments. He founded a network of IVF clinics called ARC Fertility, and he's a former president of the American Society for Reproductive Medicine.
My assessment personally is that I think they've made the right decision.
Adamson says suspending treatments also reduces the current burden on the healthcare system by encouraging patients to stay home.
But make no mistake, there are definitely women and men who are being harmed by not being able to do IVF. But we have to look at the greater good of society, and there's still too many unanswered questions to say it's okay to go ahead right now.
Dr. Eve Feinberg is an associate professor of obstetrics and gynecology at Northwestern University and is on the task force that wrote the new guidelines. She said it isn't just COVID-19's unknown health risks that prompted them.
It was really much more about the public health concern of viral transmission.
In other words, the spread of the virus. Feinberg said by reducing the number of patients going to and from fertility appointments, that helps stop the virus from being transmitted.
I like that word.
When you're trying to get pregnant naturally, you typically have sexual intercourse with one person. and you have the risk of exposing one person.
But when you're making repeat visits to a fertility clinic over weeks or months, you can come in contact with dozens of people,
doctors, nurses,
phlebotomists, ultrasound technicians, potentially spreading the coronavirus wide.
There's chocolate,
Shelley
there's Cuddle roses.
Is single, lives in the Bay Area of California, and dearly wants to have a child.
It's a lifelong dream of mine. I just didn't find, you know, the right partner in time.
So she started fertility treatments in December. She says she wasn't surprised when her appointments were canceled, considering there was a national emergency, and she understands the reason for the suspension.
There's a whole world of us out there wanting to get fertility treatments. That's a lot of people to be continuing to go out and be exposed and exposing other people. But, you know, I'm not going to lie, you know, being 44 and still wanting to get pregnant with my own biological baby using my own eggs, this timing is critical. Every month feels like an egg wasted, you know?
The National Task Force that wrote the recommendation says it's meeting every 2 weeks to consider updating them, and its next update is due April 14th. Sasha Pfeiffer, NPR News.
How are Americans who haven't gotten sick spending their time during the coronavirus when they're supposed to stay put?
Well, we put that question to some of the folks
participating in our Outbreak Diaries project. Here's what they told us.
So be themed.
I'm Eric Futterman, and I live in Richmond, Virginia.
Optical.
I went outside and dusted off the lawnmower and mowed the lawn in the spring and the sunshine with the birds chirping. And that was pretty glorious. And it wouldn't have been had it not been for this pandemic.
My name is Natasha Sanders, and I live in North Hollywood, California. I'm stuck inside, and there's no
constant stress for heavy drinking.
Been baking many cookies. That's how I have baked.
What
so
are you doing
many
here?
Cookies.
This is Ben Hinkle in Charlotte, North Carolina. I really don't have much to do. So naturally today I'm going to dye my hair because that is what one does when you have nothing to do.
Mirage.
Deborah Weppelman, Friday, April 3rd, 2020. I'm furloughed indefinitely.
Morning.
My health insurance is still active for now, so I've been cramming in getting all my prescriptions filled. But in the meantime, I've been out in the yard.
Perfect.
Right
this
now, I'm walking the cat. You heard that. I'm walking the cat.
This is Elizabeth Wilburn, and you are about to listen to a few minutes of fun cast from a Zoom call with an extended family in New Jersey.
Lacked a filter.
How are you doing, Steph? How
That's
are you
a
feeling?
Card.
Okay,
Let's, yes.
Just keep drinking your quarantinis.
I have a little wine in my mug right now. I have three tennis
that's
balls.
Good.
Hi, this is Amanda Villanio. I'm currently still unemployed, but right now my dog and I are in the hallway of our apartment building waiting for two other quarantine friends who have dogs to meet up. We throw the tennis ball down the hallway, the dogs get to play, and we all just kind of chat and talk.
This is Gwenefay McCormick in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. And we've been self-isolating and just spending time together and with my grandmother and cooking together, making sourdough from our own homemade starter, which has been really fun and delicious and fattening. And we've been getting to go to our neighborhood and meet all of our neighbors more, you know, from 6 feet apart, of course, but it's really complicated, the feelings that I have and that I'm sure a lot of people have who aren't sick and who won't get sick because... You just have all this time to do the things that you don't typically get to do.
Elevation.
Complicated feelings for
that's
many of us. As
your average Joe, probably.
Those were just some of the voices from our Outbreak Diaries
podcast.
And you've got questions amid this pandemic. Should you disinfect your groceries? When should you really wear a mask? When will we have a coronavirus vaccine? Will we get answers? Well, we will get answers from experts. Tune in tomorrow morning. Tune in tomorrow evening for the national conversation with All Things Considered, Monday night at 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific. And you can ask your questions now. Go to npr.org/nationalconversation.
Just an average show.
You're listening. listening to Weekend Edition from NPR News. Many of us, the fortunate ones, let's face it, are staying home, sheltering in place, and perhaps ordering in food, delivered most likely by a gig worker. Contracting through apps like Postmates and Uber Eats, these essential workers dash food from A to B in the middle of a pandemic, and often without full-time benefits. Workers like Jeff Kirby, he's an independent contractor who lives in Chicago, and he delivers food by bike.
For me, it's pretty simple. Either or I have a hard time paying rent.
It
was a pretty easy decision to just continue and see how things go from day to day and from week to week.
What would happen, though, if you got sick and were unable to work? Could you claim unemployment?
Currently, we are able to claim unemployment after the new federal bill, but here in Illinois, they're still working on setting up
the system. What does that mean? So it's another like, is it poker?
7 weeks. So if I get sick, I would have to
take some medicine and
ride it out for a couple weeks.
He's taking precautions, hand sanitizer after every drop-off, daily bike cleaning. Jeff Kirby says some of the companies he works with have sent cleaning supplies, but he's still without one essential.
I'm waiting on some masks to come in the mail, probably, this coming week.
In western Michigan, Michaelita Fortier has been filling orders on Instacart, a grocery pickup and delivery app. Fortier had been on the platform last year from March to October.
But as the month went on,
far from your average Joe.
That it wasn't worth my time, so I stopped.
Fast forward to COVID-19.
I knew that there was going to be a need for us to go out and do the work for those who can't come outside.
Instacart is on a hiring spree. It's planning on adding 300,000 more gig workers in the next few months to deal with heightened demand. But Fortier says it's still not a lucrative job. She thinks delivery drivers should be eligible for hazard pay. And until this week, she was unable to get personal protective equipment like hand sanitizer and disinfectant wipes from the company.
We're out in the stores. We're in the public.
Having colors and watches.
There's so many other things that are involved with what we do. And Instacart really hasn't addressed the value of what we're doing.
Some Instacart shoppers went on strike last week, refusing to accept orders in demand for more protections. Fortier says she opted for a selective approach, only accepting large orders, those with payouts reflective of the time and risk. She says most customers have been gracious. One even left a handwritten message outside the door.
And the note read, Michaelita, thank you for shopping for our family. I am a cancer survivor and don't feel comfortable being in crowds. You are greatly appreciated, the Johnson. And it made me cry because I can just imagine how people feel if they can't go outside and they may not have family who can go get groceries for them.
So gig workers like Michaelita Fortier and Jeff Kirby are out there doing it for them.
Try out a series of phone
Edition is a production of NPR News, which is solely responsible for its content. Like a story you heard on this or another NPR program, share it with a friend at npr.org. While there, you can also hear stories you missed, enjoy expanded content, or connect to your favorite member station.
Finch 00 say.
This is NPR News.
And this is WGBH. Good morning, sunshine, 42 in Boston.
What's the just ahead on Weekend Edition, prayer.
The Puzzle Master and a listener from Montana. That's next.
What's that called?
Boston's local NPR.
It's hands-free listening. If you have a smart speaker at home or a voice-activated device in your car, just say, play WGBH radio. Trusted local news is just a call away.
Press the issue.
Our programs are made possible thanks to you and the Worcester Business Development Corporation, developing the Worcester community through private investment and strategic partnerships, including one with WGBH to open their newest news bureau in Worcester this spring. WBDC.com. And Harvard Student Agency's tutoring, providing one-on-one tutoring and group courses, all taught by Harvard students. HSA tutors are committed to sharing their love of learning. More at hsatutoring.com.
really like this sort of epic
week. Beautiful Sunday. Highs in the 50s this afternoon. Rain tonight. 42 in Boston. I'm Lori London with these headlines. The world is celebrating Easter at a distance, with most churches closed and family gatherings canceled amid coronavirus shutdowns. In the United States, the death toll of over 20,000 is now the world's highest. While New York has been the epicenter, there are concerns rising about the numbers of cases growing in the Midwest. Huge uncertainties are looming about the outlook, not just for the next few weeks, but for the months ahead. The threat of severe weather in the Deep South is posing an added threat to communities trying to protect themselves from the virus. Thunderstorms and powerful tornadoes in the forecast today could impact more than 4.5 million people from Alabama to the Tennessee Valley. This is NPR News.
Okay, let me guess. Probably both, so.
Support for NPR comes from this station.
Sony.
And from the Arcus Foundation, dedicated to the idea that people can live in harmony with one another and the natural world. Learn more about Arcus and its partners at arcusfoundation.org. From Rice University, working to contribute to the betterment of the world through a commitment to transformative education and research.
Rice University, I'm done.
Set in the heart of Houston, Texas.